Your brain is like a supercomputer and your self-talk is a program it will run. So if you tell yourself you're not good at remembering names, you will not remember the name of the next person you meet because you program your supercomputer not to. And I always tell people that your self-talk is important and it is the program that we will run. And I always tell people to keep it positive, keep it empowering, because your mind is always eavesdropping on your self-talk, right? And you have to be careful what you say to yourself because it's this unconscious command. So I would be very careful, like when I get nervous or I feel like I think some of the most successful people live at the edge of their limits, you know, and they play there also as well. And whenever I feel in my nervous system, I feel like I can't do it, then I feel like I really must do it because I feel like how we do anything is how we do everything. Knowledge is power, then learning is your superpower. I had the brain injury when I was 5 years old, and I suffered all through elementary school, all through middle school, all through high school. And so it was like a good 14 years of, and a lot of it was, you know, this thing where it's, even as a young age, maybe I was pretending that everything was fine and I'd be struggling. It's kind of like that metaphor of a duck on a pond, and you see it's like all calm and relaxed, but underneath it's just like hustling really, really fast. And people don't always see what's below the iceberg. But for me, I struggled privately. And my parents, because I grew up with these challenges and I didn't have a lot of people to talk to, because when you feel like you're broken, you don't connect with a lot of people. So on top of everything, I was also painfully shy. I was introverted, but I was also shy and very reserved. And I would always sit in the corner. And I honestly, I've never talked about this publicly, but I ask everybody, you know, what their superpower is. And I feel like that my superpower growing up as an insecure kid who feels like he was broken and taught that by adults, that my superpower was being invisible.
Whoa.
Like, I didn't want to be seen. I mean, I ultimately did want to be seen and I want to be heard, like most of us, and accepted and acknowledged, but I didn't want the spotlight. Like, I would do, for example, my parents instilled like this work ethic about working hard, and so I would do a book report, and even though it was more difficult for me, and to the point where I'd be like, okay, I have it, I was done, but if a teacher asked me in high school to present it in front of a class, I would actually lie and say I didn't do it. Wow. And I would take a zero, and because I was so terrified of being in front of a group of people, and I would throw it out on the way out of class. What you practice in private, they say you're rewarded for in public, but you have to do the work. And I think that's where I got my work ethic. The challenges is growing up with a brain injury and labeled the boy with a broken brain. I had to work so much harder as everybody else, and you wonder why you're not getting those results. So I think having a powerful mindset, being unstoppable, or just having the ability to go and succeed, whatever success is for you, you have to be growing, because if you're not growing, then you're just backsliding, right? But you also need a level of grit. And I think grit, just like growth, is a muscle. It's something that you need to sharpen through challenge, because through the challenge, you get all the change that comes from it. I would say that if I'm effective having an impact on stage, and we all have a stage of our life, whether it's on a physical stage or, you know, just going through our day,
right.
That I challenge my grit and my ability to persist, because motive matters, right? And what drives us. I always tell people that there's a success formula. I subscribe to it. I call it H-cubed, that it goes from your head to your heart to your hands. Especially in the personal development space or what they teach about goal setting, you could affirm things in your head or think things in your head or visualize things in your head. But if you're not acting with your hands, there's something that's missing, right? There's an incongruency there. And what I tell people is, like, you know, check in with the second H, which is your heart, which is the symbol of like emotion, the energy of motion. And so I feel like that's the fuel that fuels the car that gets you to take action for something. And I do believe what got me through it is figuring out what my why was, right? I don't want people to suffer the way I did. If I could do anything about it, for me, it's like no brain left behind, right? Because I live with that identity for so long. And my message to people, whether it's on stage or on the podcast or anything, is that, you know, we are more than what we're demonstrating, that we've been sold this lie, that people are taught through school. Like when I do these demos and I on stage memorize 100 names and words and numbers, forwards and backwards, and it appears effortlessly, I always tell people, I don't do this to impress you, I do this to express to you what's really possible, because the truth is everyone can do this too, and so much more. Apply towards creativity and focus and flow and problem solving and thinking and and really to overcoming the biggest challenges of their life and maybe even the world. The challenge is we were taught a lie. We were taught a lie that somehow our intelligence, our potential, our learning, our memory somehow is fixed, our creativity is fixed, our thinking is fixed, like our shoe size. And what we've discovered, you know, as you know, more about brain science, in the past 2 decades, we've discovered more than the previous 2,000 years. And what we know is that we're grossly underestimating its capacity, our own capacity to be able to grow, to be able to contribute, to improve our intelligence and our influence and our impact. And I want to kind of pull the veil behind and just say, hey, this is about transcending. You know, this is about ending the trance that we're not good enough, you know, that we're not smart enough, that we're not this genius, and telling the truth. And the truth is, we're faster and we're smarter than we think. And not just to be able to rote memorize things, but be able to really solve significant challenges. And maybe that these challenges that we're going through are the lessons that we need to learn the most. And then some people who learn those lessons feel compelled to be able to share that voice with other people. So it's not just one candle, you know, we just can set things ablaze. My platform is education. And I feel like that growing up, if anyone who's watching this feels like they're overloaded, overwhelmed, and they can't keep up, I always tell people that I don't think it's completely their fault. It's just we all grew up with a 20th century education that prepared us for a 20th century world, which at the turn of the century was working in factories and farms and assembly line, and our education system was mirrored to that. It was assembly line, one size fits all, cookie cutter approach towards education, teaching us things about what to learn, math, history, science, Spanish, but all things we could find online nowadays, right? So what do you need to be able to regurgitate that information for? But it was about what to learn, but not how to learn. And you know, how to think for yourself, how to solve problems, how to be creative, all the things that you can't outsource to, you know, to automated or technology, or you can't outsource to Asia. You know, our value in this world is really our creativity. Right, because that's not something that's easily outsourced. Our ability to create value, be creators, take our vision and turn them into reality, take the invisible and make it visible. But where are the classes on that, right? On how to be able to live your best version of yourself. But I love this because right now classrooms, you know, they don't have four walls. I mean, how many people are watching this from how many different countries right now? And you never know who's listening on the other side. And that motivates, inspires the heck out of me. Because what if someone right now is watching this on their smart device and they, you know, they're in the middle of some, like a third world country, and they become the next Malala or Elon Musk or what have you.
Right.
And that's what really juices me. And so education, I feel like a lot of people feel like that when they graduate school, their learning is done. Mm. In fact, the two big dips in cognitive performance is usually when people graduate school. And the second one is when they retire. Like what I'm thinking about when I want to transform or transcend or make a real positive change, I'm looking at all the other areas of ourself. So I'm looking at, for example, our environment. Are people setting up their environment to win? So change doesn't just happen at this level of behavior, but what you have to change the environment. So for example, if you want to stop eating a certain food, it helps to be able to not have that food in your home, right? So you change the environment. If you want to read more, it helps to help set up your environment where you have the books readily available, where you're going to read it, because they perform, you know, how I approach habit change is this area of motivation and this trigger, right? You want a trigger to help remind you to do the behavior, right? So are you setting up the environment in a way that triggers the behavior that you want? But not only the environment is like the when and the where, but it's also the behavior is also the capabilities, because a lot of people want to change a behavior, but they're not training in the abilities. It's exercise when we talk about self-awareness being a superpower, really knowing who we think we are. Because if we don't believe that we're a public speaker, or we're a great parent, or we're a great learner or genius, then we'll never be able to reach our full potential, because that will always be the ceiling that we bump up against. There's certain times of the day it's better to work out. There's better times of the day to be able to make love. There are better times of the day to be able to read, to check email, to ask for a raise. So I would think about, like, if geniuses find their element, their sweet spot, and they set up their routines and their rituals throughout the day to be able to align with their time when they're most productive, right? If they're not have a lot of energy in the morning, working out is probably not as good as doing some other time. So the when and the where, and setting up your environment for success, because all your triggers are there that allow them. So I think geniuses set themselves up. So for example, they have their laptop, but they only use their laptop for work, and it's anchored, that's part of their environment, it's anchored to get them into flow states to be able to write or be productive. They don't use their laptop to binge on Netflix, right? They have an iPad that they use when they do that, because that's the state that they want to anchor for that, and they don't use that iPad to do work. And so my thing when it comes to success rituals and high performance and making an impact is that we all have that sovereignty, we all have that power, and whenever we put it out there and give it out to somebody else, like we're a thermometer, right? The metaphor I always talk about, it's like we're either thermometers or we're thermostats. And a thermometer, you think about the functionality of it, it just reflects what the environment is giving it, right? It just reflects the temperature and stuff. But a thermostat is different. It sets a standard, it sets a goal, it sets a vision, and the environment changes along with it. And I feel like our happiness, our joy, our level of fulfillment, our success is all dependent on where we put the locus of control. And I feel like we have more power than we realize in these cases. And it's hard because we have to fight media, we have to fight marketing that's always telling us about all the things that are going on in the world. But we live in an abundant universe, right? I mean, we talk about the matrix, you know, which pill people are gonna take, and that determines everything. And every single morning, you determine what color pill you're gonna take. You know, I watch and I listen to your show and maybe a handful of things I read each day because I need to keep it positive. I want hope and I'm looking for help. I'm looking for inspiration and also instruction.